Clinical trials are very useful in determining many different questions. So a researcher comes up with a question and says, all right, this is my question. How am I going to get to an answer? So, and whatever the question may be, maybe it's a drug, maybe it's an observation and needs to be proven. And so we design either a trial or some sort of experiment to try to answer that. So when it comes to the drug trials, it's very simple. Does this medicine work and is it safe for that particular patient? So we design various types of clinical trials and various phases of clinical trials. So some of the different types you'll hear is phase one, phase two, phase three. Phase one clinical trial describes your essentially safety. So we know this works preclinically, so either in the lab or in animals. And we know it's safe in that animal population. And the phase ones are generally the first in human studies really to determine if the drug is safe. Every now and again, we'll look for hints of efficacy, but really a phase one trial is designed for safety. When it comes to phase two trials, we've already gone through the phase one, so we know it's safe. So now it's a matter of saying, all right, we know it's safe, we know the dose of it. Now, does this work in a small sample size of patients? So generally we'll put a patient on this particular drug with a particular type of cancer, and we'll use a small population, like about 40 patients generally, and say, put the 40 patients on and follow them through and find out, one, did it work? Did it shrink tumors? Did it prolong survival? You know, whatever question we were looking for to see if it worked. And then two, was it safe for the patient? Then based on the result of the phase two, we may decide to go to a phase three study. And a phase three is simply recreating the phase two question in a large population. So while your phase two may have been in 40 patients, your phase three may be in 200 patients.
Clinical trials, one of the tools and the most important tools by which we move our treatments forward. And back in 1980s, the only way or the robust way to treat neuroendocrine tumors was somatostatin analog. Now we have targeted therapies. We have radionuclide radiation-based therapies. We are exploring into TKIs or immunotherapies. That is our biggest strength and the strongest tool we have to explore new treatment options, clinical trials.
In terms of clinical trials, we also try to explain what clinical trials are. I think that some patients believe that they don't want to be a guinea pig on a clinical trial, and so we try to talk about how there's a detailed informed consent process for clinical trials. We would explain exactly what the clinical trial would entail. It is something that clinical trials do not guarantee benefit, and the patient is really in the driver's seat in terms of making the decision.
The pivotal trials in NET for the last 5 years that have moved the needle, that have changed our standard of care, would include the everolimus trials. These trials were first tested in pancreatic neuroendocrine tumors, tested in GI neuroendocrine tumors, and about 3 years ago became approved in all neuroendocrine tumors. So everolimus was sentinel in our management, improving our management of neuroendocrine tumors. Other trials, the sunitinib trial for pancreatic neuroendocrine tumor, the telotrastat trial in carcinoid syndrome diarrhea, and the most recent one, the NETTER-1, or the Lutathera trial, PRRT, peptide receptor radiotherapy, in the management of gut neuroendocrine, GEP-NETs, gastroenteropancreatic neuroendocrine tumors.
PRRT therapy is a fantastic new modality that we use to treat people with lower grade neuroendocrine tumors. And the reason we use PRRT is it's been proven to be very effective through clinical trials. The Netter trial came out relatively recently, and that was a really big deal in the neuroendocrine world.
So the key trial that led to the approval of PRRT, specifically lutetium 177 dotatate, was called Netter 1, and that was a prospective, multi-center, randomized, double-blinded study that looked at the efficacy of lutetium 177 dotatate in patients who had been progressing on standard dose octreotide with specifically only mid-gut neuroendocrine tumors. So it's not for all the other types of neuroendocrine tumors that are out there. And the primary endpoint was progression-free survival. So from once the therapy is completed, how long does it take for the progression of the disease to happen again?
Without clinical trials, we would still be limited with our treatment options. So I would encourage all our patients to look into clinical trial options and discuss them with your medical oncologist and see if they can participate in a clinical trial which might be relevant to their disease type.
Clinical trials are critical for NET patients if we're ever going to move the needle. We have to do better than the standard of care. Until this disease is cured, we have to constantly be looking at alternative management.